As always, Dr. Satterly brings creative energy and fun to his pursuits, and he uses this approach to reveal new insights. Dr. Satterly is this year's winner of the Faculty Institutional Leadership Award. And I can tell you personally that he's also a wise and thoughtful colleague. My discussions with him about organizational change have been very valuable in my work. He truly is an institutional leader. Brent is an associate professor of social work and the director of the BSW program in the School of Human Service Professions. His institutional leadership includes modeling student-centered engagement as an outstanding teacher, supporting and mentoring faculty in their teaching and scholarship, and deep involvement in major roles in faculty governance. He served as advisor to student clubs and service initiatives, and he's led a number of admissions efforts. In short, he has done it all. And through his work, he embodies our values as a university. Dr. Satterly earned his PhD in human sexuality education from the University of Pennsylvania, his master's of social service from Bryn Mawr College, and his bachelor's degree in psychology from Eastern College. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Brent Satterly.
To speak to you today, I would like to thank you and thank our own headmistress. headmistress, Dr. Julie Walden, president of Widener University, for the honor and opportunity. Thank you very much. What? What's that you said? Some of you are not witches or wizards? Muggles. I see. That's all right. Muggles, for those of you who don't know, are non-magic folk. But fear not. You're all welcome here. You see, one thing that we in the magical community here at Widener have learned over these last few years since the defeat of Lord Voldemort is this. We are all Widener, and all are welcome. Which brings me to the topic of today's headmistress's lecture, excuse me, president's lecture, Dumbledore's Army, Leadership in Resistance and Authenticity. Please forgive me in advance, dear Muggles, for I plan on using many references to the wizarding world, which you may not understand. Do not worry. I am sure that there are plenty of magical geeks in this room who will explain it to you after the lecture. Just ask a Ravenclaw. They will explain it to you in great detail, over and over, in great depth, on and on and on, using plenty of examples extensively. And also, please grant me some forbearance. This speech is somewhat narcissistic in its flavor. I know you're surprised. I was always taught to write about what I know. So much of this is about me. I'm a social worker, and when I teach, I am the tool. And now, class is in session. I genuinely believe that in order to embrace your own magic, you need to start with embracing your whole self. So that is where I will begin. You see, I was always different. In fact, for over two decades, I learned how to be a really good liar. In a world where being a gay sissy boy is often met with hostility, rejection, and even violence, I learned how to hide. The closet is indeed a lonely place, but it taught me that embracing authenticity is a form of resistance to injustice. What's that? Did you know I was gay? I clutch my umbrage pearls. You know, I'm sometimes shocked when folks assume that I'm straight. My husband sometimes giggles in those moments and will comment, "Really? They think you're straight? Wow. I always thought that you could walk past the cemetery and all the residents would know that you're gay." But here's the cornrows. By the way, it's okay to laugh. Then, even when people meet me for the first time, they often think I'm gay. Not because of my love or whom I'm attracted to, but because I'm feminine. In my mannerisms, in my characteristics, and even in my voice. People often confuse one's masculinity or femininity with their sexual orientation. I'm gay, and I'm feminine in my presentation of self. And that combination in the way I identify myself makes me a gay sissy boy. In fact, I am the quintessential out and proud gay sissy boy. And in my identity, it has taken me years of hard work to learn how to celebrate that in spite of the shaming messages that this world hurls at folks like me. But as I previously mentioned, the closet is a painful, albeit unforgiving and lonely teacher. And as were the in-betweens. The in-betweens are times and spaces and places where adult eyes are absent. You see, the in-betweens are basically where the adult world vanished, as if an invisibility cloak winked it out of existence. Such in-betweens included the bus stop, the playground, the hallways, the walk home, the ball field, the curbside, church basements, parking lots, the county fair, the mall, and yes, even family gatherings and friend hangouts. But the worst in-between was the closet. That is, being alone with myself. That's where those shaming and hurtful messages did the most damage. And now, my friends, I've come to a part of the lecture where I must speak some painful truths. And I may at times use terms that offend. So, in the words of Professor Snape, teaching Harry Potter the skill of occlumency, prepare yourself! When I was a child, and for that matter, an adolescent, a young adult, someone in midlife, I was bullied pretty viciously for many reasons. One of which was because I used to carry around a fabulous green purse you will see right over here. mesmerized by the show, the music, the lights. Although I was really worried about the animals, especially the cats. After the show, we got some cotton candy and I saw it. A shining sword. About the size of Bilbo's sting. It was plastic, but to me, it was magnificent. I asked if I could have it, and to my surprise, my parents bought it for me. I beamed, imagining myself fighting off monsters, ghouls, and dark wizards. I even took it to school the next day, fully armored with my green purse and my sting. At recess, I ran outside, so excited to fight the good fight of defeating such dementors. The first person I ran into by accident was Billy. Billy was a bully. A large, angry, and the social worker in me says, probably a really abused kid. He took one look at my sword and my purse. He grabbed my sting and proceeded to snap it in half right in front of me. He cackled like all bullies do and pushed me down. I hit the pavement with a resounding thump and he threw my broken sting at me. Tears immediately sprang to my eyes and I wanted to scream. I didn't know at that moment if I was in childhood shock or if it just ignited a fury in me that I had never known. I pulled myself up and away from the group of billies that continued to verbally assault me and others around me. Leaving broken sting on the pavement, I walked slowly over to a pile of small river stones lying nearby off the ground. I emptied my purse of its contents, all of its precious security, and proceeded to fill it with those stones. I weighed its contents in my palms. It was heavy. It was strong. And for the first time, I felt strong. I remember turning slowly and seeing Billy shove another kid down hard on the pavement, much like me a few minutes before. I slowly walked over to Billy, who was assaulting everyone with verbal, vitriolic verbiage. And with a mighty backswing, I smacked him with my green purse and all its rocky power square in the face. My own monster had fallen. I don't remember much of what happened after that. The in-between disappeared, winked out, as a teacher finally decided to shove her face. I do recall gathering my Deathly Hallows and holding my purse against my tummy. And while I dumped the stones out, I kept three. I never saw Billy again. Now hear me, am I advocating violence against the billies of the world? The answer to that question is an unequivocal no. I was just a kid, and that's sometimes how kids respond. We are not children. That in-between of being bullied and the closet of self-hatred and toxic loathing that tried to end me taught me in one of my most valuable lessons in leadership. I am me, and I'm okay. In all of my weirdness, in all of my geekiness, in all of my queerness, in all of my sissy boyness, this is me. That experience taught me that we must stand up to any display of bullying, hatred, prejudice, or discrimination. I'm saying that we must learn to speak to each other in kindness and compassion. We must be a beacon of hope to the vulnerable and the oppressed. We must lead. Those aren't just words, they are in fact the very stuff of who we are. It was all of this that taught me my next important lesson about leadership. We must care about justice. I could never get it when people would say disparaging things about women in my childhood or adolescence. All the women who cared for me in my life were strong, but kind and loving. My mother, my grandmother, my stepmother, my teachers. And many of the men who loved me could be nurturing and caring, yet firm. My father, my grandfathers, and even my pain in the butt Big Brother met, in his own way. Perhaps all their role modeling empowered me to embrace myself. It just took time, because the world is harsh to people who are different. Be they squibs or sissy boys, house elves or heavyset girls, an obscurus or an immigrant, muggle or a person of color. But resisting injustice in an authentic way makes me a Gryffindor. It makes me an advocate, a change agent, a professor, and a social worker. So what are the implications of such resistance? It certainly empowers me to act, but it also doesn't allow me to be a bystander. It helps me do perspective taking, challenging my own biases, and doesn't allow me to choose who is worthy of advocacy and understanding. It builds the foundation of compassion and empathy, and doesn't allow me to ignore the pain of the addicted, the mentally ill, the impoverished, the oppressed, the homeless, the abused child, the victimized spouse, or the exploited community. And it is that authentic self and resistance that allows me to access the magic of my own feelings, not allowing me to ignore my own heart, which is in fact the best diagnostician I've ever met. Practicing being authentic is in and of itself resistance. It is resistance against the darkness of self-loathing, resistance against a world that often seeks to rob us of our power, resistance against our own unique closets. You see, lying for 2 decades is exhausting. Right? And in the words of Headmaster Dumbledore's cousin, Gandalf the Grey, when he broke the hold of Satterly on King Theoden of Rohan, breathe the free air, my friend. And the free air outside the closet is free and full of powerful magic. I know the geeks in the room are going to go after me for mixing up fandom canons. Sorry about it. So, with those 2 lessons about leadership, my grand quest brought me here to Widener. When I started at Widener, I had to figure out who I would be as an out faculty member, a queer colleague, a gay leader. I remember walking into the cafeteria and seeing the Confederate flag hanging on the wall. I was quite taken aback. And while I grew up in hunting country in rural Pennsylvania, where I saw many of those flags on many a pickup truck, I always believed that such a symbol reflected a history of treason and racism. I didn't know what it meant to hear a Widener hanging on the wall in one of the most prominent areas of the university. Now, I respect the history of our great institution, but I knew I needed to find myself here, and yet I wondered if I could. It wasn't until, once again, I had a rush with fear because of bigotry that I knew Widener was my home. When I was an adjunct many years ago, I was driving to class on McDade Boulevard. My window was down because it was a warm day. I had a rainbow sticker on the car, which symbolizes LGBTQ pride. A group of guys came flying up behind me, honking their horn. They zoomed up next to me and began shouting, "Faggot! We're gonna kill you! We're gonna murder you, faggot!" I rolled up my window as they zoomed around my car, continuing to hurl insults and epithets at me. As I got closer to Widener, they zoomed off cackling. I pulled up in front of the social work office, shaking. My dean and a colleague were out in front chatting. When she saw me, she surmised my state and asked if I was okay. I explained what had happened, and after calming me down and reassuring me of my safety, she asked me how they knew I was gay. I must have mumbled something about maybe that my rainbow sticker in my car, I don't know, and then went off to teach class. The next week, when I came to teach, I was taken aback when I noted rainbow sticker after rainbow sticker, on car after car, and door office after door office. My social work colleagues had decided to stand in solidarity with me, just because of who they are, who we are. The headmaster of Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry, Albus Dumbledore, said, "It's in our choices, rather than in our abilities, that show us who we truly are." Now please understand, when my colleagues chose to put stickers on their cars and doors, they didn't do so lightly. They did so with the full knowledge that when you choose to become an ally and stand in solidarity, you also choose to become a target. That takes courage and conviction and leadership. I knew I had found a safe harbor, a home, a burrow full of weirdos like me, who believed in themselves and in standing for justice. I love you all so much. And while my colleagues showed me their authenticity and their courage in the face of I still sometimes struggle with navigating others' expectations of my professionalism. Even as an adult, my old sissy phobia and homophobia reared their monstrous heads inside me. I wanted to be successful here. I wanted to be accepted, loved. I worried that my colleagues might think of my geekdom and glitterness bizarre. It was then that I found the best source of authentic inspiration right in front of my magical nose, my students. You see, Dumbledore's army was no faculty committee. It was no higher education course, no institutionally funded club. It was, at its core, resistance to injustice. It was, knowing is, a secret student organization designed to learn the spellcraft of resistance to that which sought to harm them. And then, the brilliant Hermione, without whom, by the way, Harry Potter would not have lived through the first freaking book. Just so we're clear. She organized the army and sought a proper teacher, Harry himself. And in signing up for the army, they each put proverbial rainbow stickers on their doors and cars. They risked themselves in the service of justice. Of course, there's a sentiment that Hermione so excitedly expressed. It's so exciting, isn't it? Breaking rules. My apologies to all the administrators in the room, but sometimes policies, rules, procedures, and laws must be resisted because they are simply unjust. I taught them, the Army, my undergraduates, my master's students, and my doctoral students, and they quickly showed me something magical. Their desire to learn, their intellectual thirst, and mostly, their passionate and compassionate commitment to justice in an unjust world. I saw Dumbledore's army in every classroom. It is indeed why now, in every course, I proclaim my motto loudly to them during the first session. Students are the most important part of Widener University. I will say that again. Students are the most important part of Widener University. It's why we are here. Of course, undergrads haven't figured out what they're not supposed to say in class yet. Graduate students often censor themselves for fear of offending someone. And doctoral students, well, they simply pontificate using big words, like pontificate. But I watch them, and I listen to them. You see, in social work and human sexuality, we challenge, we push, and stretch our students around personhood. They must explore their history. They must explore their personal values, their inner strengths, their daily struggles, and yes, often even their own trauma. In watching them, they taught me three things about being yourself authentically. First, I discovered a sense of interpersonal humility. I am who I am, and I cannot be someone else. One of my biggest pet peeves that I sometimes see in academia, with apologies, is faculty arrogance. I never understood how some folks seemed to think that they were better than other people. Now granted, perhaps I was misinterpreting behavior and attributing arrogance to a person incorrectly, and I also recognize that there are cultural differences here, so I am humbly just naming my observations. But when I saw such behavior, talking down to a student, not thanking a custodial staff when they empty your trash, telling a junior faculty member to frankly be quiet in meetings. It was usually from a power base of top-down seniority. My grandma Kendall taught me, in her cackling voice, "Ready? You remember this! Nobody is better than you! And you aren't better than anyone else! But sweetie," she touched my cheek, "you'll always get more bees to honey than vinegar." And so, much like Lily, as echoed in Harry, I learned a lesson of humility and kindness in words of one wise crone, whom I revere and miss to this day. When I served as faculty chair, which is kind of like being the queen of the faculty, if the faculty were a bunch of cats who I was charged and tasked with herding, and I love cats, but reality and cooperation. In my opening speech, I remember quoting John Wooden, who said, "Be more concerned with your character than with your reputation. Your character is what you are, is what you really are, while your reputation is merely what others think you are." It's quite freeing, actually. And I'm proud to say that this faculty rose to the occasion. They, you, are in fact some of the most committed, brilliant, and inspiring people that I have ever met. Each of you with your own magic and perspectives, each one committed to making this world a better place. I am proud to be among you. From my students, I also learned courageous self-awareness. "There are all kinds of courage," said Dumbledore, smiling. "It takes a great deal of bravery to stand up to our enemies, but just as much to stand up to our friends." This he said to the bumbling Neville Longbottom, a Gryffindor first-year student who was clearly bullied. Spoiler alert, turns out Neville saves the day in the end. Not to mention growing up in a major body. I was talking about somewhere else. That was a joke. Dumbledore said this quote to the first-year Gryffindor in the context of Neville standing up to Harry, Hermione and Ron for breaking the rules. Neville, like many first-year students at Hogwarts, felt a new sensation of belonging somewhere, and in this instance, Gryffindor House. As such, Neville was willing to take a stand for something that he believed in, even at the risk of being petrified by Hermione, which he was. We are lifelong learners. Anyone who thinks that they have arrived at the penultimate knowledge of self, their complexities, their contradictions, their values, is often at risk for embracing the arrogance I spoke of previously. While Harry is teaching the army such spells as the Patronus Charm, the witch or wizard must call upon a profound memory that brings them great joy and happiness. Only those who are aware of themselves, their cognitive processes, their emotional literacy, their pensieve of memories, if you will, can invoke such a charm. Knowing yourself, you see, requires humility in the first lesson from my students, and it allows us to know one another much more fully. And finally, I learned to embrace my cultural flair. Let's face it, I'm weird, and I love it. My office is full of Harry Potter paraphernalia. You should see my charm wizard come. I sometimes teach in costumes, spinning yarns and fairy tales, or singing songs. I do high kicks when I'm excited. My closet, my actual clothing closet, has love notes posted all over its walls for my husband. I belt out Broadway tunes while seat dancing in the car at red lights. I obsess about Halloween starting on November 1st. And I squeal when I get a gift. Queen Elsa is totally one of my heroes. And I eat my pizza with a fork and knife, don't judge me. And I believe in magic. We all have this cultural flair all our own. We all have those unique things that make us oddly beautiful. When we learn to embrace them in ourselves, we learn to see them then in others, encourage them in others, grow together in our oddity into an army of unstoppable misfits. So authenticity requires that we bravely and humbly learn to know and love our true selves. That's indeed much more scarier than you think. But that humble courage also helps us to see the Gryffindor bravery in others as they take risks to know and be themselves as well. And together, this courage creates magic that allows us to confront injustice in the world. And from that space, we draw power from our weirdness to resist. My friends, in a world where difference often breeds discrimination, there are too many examples of injustice in our nation to even try to name them all. I love my country. Progressives can be patriots too. Much of my family has served our country in the military, including making the ultimate sacrifice. But I would be doing a disservice if I didn't plainly state that the United States of America began with the slaughter and displacement of an entire First Nations people. Throughout our history, much of our country was built on the backs of people with brown and black and yellow skin. And I'm ashamed to say, in my own field of social work, that we, in fact, were complicit with the formation and maintenance of Japanese internment camps in World War II. In fact, much of the field of human services as a whole has a dark mark of complicity that stains them. Tuskegee, the AIDS crisis, ignoring the seemingly never-ending examples of sexual exploitation and harassment of women. These are the ways that we, in our desire to help, can maintain systems of institutionalized power that continue to oppress. Of course, I cannot deliver a speech on justice and resistance without acknowledging my own reaction to what I deem a series of codified acts of injustice in policy and action in the current presidential administration. Yes, I'm going here. I have no shame in saying that after the 2016 presidential election, I was devastated. I felt betrayed by people that I love, by my country that I love, and terrified for both. But in the words of Dolores Umbridge, let me make this quite plain. I am not disparaging Republicans. My grandma Campbell was one. I work every day to have robust, balanced, socio-political conversations in my classroom, making space for all opinions and perspectives. I believe in our democracy, but I will not normalize this administration. You know, I had recently, finally, been able to legally marry my husband and had it recognized in all 50 states. And I cannot tell you how grateful I am for that. Especially after he had a heart attack last year. And while I stood in the emergency room, frankly in traumatic shock, the doctor would not recognize me or frankly speak to me about his condition because I was a man. Yes, folks, that still happens every day. I now carry my marriage certificate in electronic form on my phone, just in case I have to prove to some dementor that he is the legal love of my life. To me, these are the dementors of history and our contemporary United States. Wait, what's a dementor? You don't know what a dementor is? Well, according to Alice Dumbledore, dementors are vicious creatures that consume human happiness, creating an ambiance of coldness, darkness, misery, and despair, as if all the happiness was gone from the world. Because of their power to drain happiness and hope from humans, they were set, in fact, on duty to guard the magical prison of Azkaban, where they prevented prisoners from having the will or the ability to escape. The Dementor's kiss, seemingly unbearable, is said to drain the human soul. And it is the Dementors that we must then resist with our whole authentic self. And to do this, we must conjure what Harry Potter lore would call our Patronus. Professor Remus Lupin, one of the many professors of Defense Against the Dark Arts teacher at Hogwarts, said that the Patronus is a kind of positive force, a projection of the very thing that Dementors feed upon, hope, happiness, the desire to survive. They generally come in the form of an animal, a stag, a doe, an otter, a rabbit, a cat. Of course, some folks in my personal circle have Patronuses that are, let's say, Cookie Monster? No. You know Cookie Monster? And the big red monster from Bugs Bunny, Gossamer. I mean, the most interesting monster. Patronus is a spell. It comes from those unique experiences from each wizard or witch's history in which we found both our authentic selves and connection to others. It comes from the unique power that each of us has developed through the hardships of our lives and that has thrown at us. When we find it, it's unique to our hearts and fueled by the magic within us. Yet once again, I turn to Dumbledore's army, my students, as inspiration. In my Harry Potter and Justice class that I taught last spring, I'm teaching again in the fall! Both for undergrads and grads. And not just social workers. Some of my students describe their Patronus as quite poignantly. One student, who worked in an inpatient psychiatric facility, disclosed her own challenges with secondary trauma in her work. Her Patronus, which she reported grounded her and helped her cope with such stress, was Mother Earth. Being outside in nature gave her peace. Another student who struggled with a rare disorder in which the body's immune system attacks part of the peripheral nervous system discovered her Olipotromus as a flamingo. She described it as, quite touchingly, an animal with the ultimate ability to balance, which helped her do the same. So, in the words of Winifred Sanderson, it's time! I want you to conjure your Patronus. Invoke your happy memory. It must be sweet, strong, powerful. It should make you tingle in your spirit. It must be authentic to your true self, full of the love you have for and from others. Now, grab something that looks like a wand and hold it aloft. Come on. Come on. Yeah, I see a lot of phones. They all sound bad. Now raise your wands. Repeat after me. Expecto Patrono.
Sky.
and join Dumbledore's army. And it is today with more Widener pride than I have felt in many a year, mischief managed. Thank you very much.
That's it.
We've lost this in 45 minutes.